Thank you. So I think all the points that were said have already been covered by the other panel members. I think all of us are maybe lucky or unlucky to be a part of such a dynamic industry for the last 5 years. I think there have been many disruptions that has happened, the latest one being the DISCOM regulations earlier. Maybe there were the module prices that shrunk down significantly. Then there was like 2.54 tariffs that came up. So that made us look into a different aspect of how do we finance these projects or how do we raise capital for these projects. Then there was a disruption about the safeguard duties that were put in place that really jumped up the prices to an extent. And then now we have seen a trend of the DISCOMs kind of being against how the policies are being frameworked. It has been there in all these states, for that matter, that the peak in the solar generation capacity for that started with UP, then Maharashtra introduced their grid support charges, and Karnataka's net metering, and how the DISCOM is being in the center. Even for Andhra Pradesh, there was a lot of, there is still a lot of hue and cry happening between the existing grid connected utility scale projects and about the tariffs that were negotiated in the past. And me also coming from a developer company, like it was rightly mentioned, these uncertainties or this dynamic nature of the market really stops us from fully exploring the true potential of this. And the true potential can only be explored when all the stakeholders come together and put in their views and come up with a collaborative approach. I think we have seen that in other countries as well, where we can take up as an example, where a lot of solar, if apart from, like, if we don't consider battery storage right now, like that will be soon in the future, solar or renewable for that matter has always been a supportive source of power, not a full-time source of power, and it can only work in tangent or in tandem with the grid infrastructure or the conventional based infrastructure. So that sort of a support technically also we need, and that sort of a support renewable also needs in terms of the regulatory framework as well. And that was given to us at a point, and now suddenly it has been taken, and it has been taken away after a lot of investment, a lot of infrastructure by all these companies were already in place. So that leaves us in a spot as well into how do we proceed forward, or how do we project ourselves in the future, and what sort of business lines are we looking at? Because like we have Tata CleanTech as well here that talked about how are they financing projects. So they would also agree that these uncertainties do not enable developers like us to have a long-term view of the cash flows that are coming, long-term view of the future that is expected. So the only solution that I can foresee, or all of us foresee, is that there has been multiple times said in the system, is a more of a collaborative approach, in which may not think about at a central level to reduce the total power purchase of the country and depend maybe a good percentage on renewable energy and treat it like a supplementary nationwide source of power, instead of just C&I customers reducing the revenue of the DISCOMs. Or maybe go forward with, like, we are all expecting battery storage to help us out and take us out of this fix, but how long do we wait for that? So we have to act upon it now, we all. So there are a lot of licensing activities that are still happening. Even for Karnataka, I'm sure a lot of us developers have petitioned in terms of how do we question this policy, ask for a public hearing. Before this, there was a public hearing for the Maharashtra. We are expecting a public hearing for KERC as well. So let us see, let us hope that all these explanations that we give the DISCOM and the government pay some heed to it, and they agree to relax certain policies and maybe phase out all these implementations, so that all these developers also have a smooth transition towards a stabler business model, if not the current business model that we are currently operating in. Thank you.
So I guess having so many of the OPEX developers in this panel, the case has been made that rooftop solar as a segment, or on-site solar as a segment, still deserves its place. It's still a very small percentage of the total renewable capacity, I can say. So it still needs this space. It's supporting the grid infrastructure in terms of reducing the load on the grid infrastructure. So the DISCOMs could do well to recognize these benefits and take the OPEX and the rooftop developers and the EPCs, the value chain, into confidence, share the ideas, probably involve us in the policy making. If I just look back in 2014-15, all of us in such conferences would generally speak about challenges to financing solar that will open up market. So financing has come in the past 4-5 years in a big way. That is what eventually enabled the OPEX market. So now financing has come in, capacity has come. Now the regulations are curtailing the growth of the segment, if I look at it that way. So I think the regulation and rooftop and on-site solar as a segment requires that regulatory support. We don't need the financial support. So one way to look at it and suggest to the DISCOMs is that you may want to reduce your tariff on the net metering units adjusted. It was 9.56 a few years back. It's around 3 rupees now. You may reduce that financial support. That's fine. But at least let the net metering or the metering regulations remain. So by doing that, we are not expecting financial support or any incentive from the DISCOMs, which are already in financial trouble. But at least you are allowing the market to remain and you are not stopping the enabling of the on-site solar market as such. So I think that's the direction in which the DISCOMs can look at. We are, since the solar prices and all have become competitive, we have achieved grid parity sometime back itself. So we are not expecting that financial support. It's just a regulatory support, which is exactly where this December order is kind of hitting at. So probably it's good to have a rethink on the order. And the other point I just wanted to make was, if this December order was put out or the decision was made, keeping in mind that they wanted to regulate the developers and all, I think it's better to regulate the quality of the system. It benefits the whole ecosystem, which the central government has done in certain tenders, in the SECI tenders and all. It's good to standardize certain system qualities rather than take a bet on which developers will remain or which kind of developers will not remain, because that's a market driven thing and investment driven thing. Somebody may survive, somebody may not. So I think the KERC should take a view from the system point of view, because eventually the DISCOM is going to manage the influx of solar from these systems. So they have a say in that. They have a, they are also an equal stakeholder. But I think, like all of us have time and again said in this panel, that it's a collaborative effort that's eventually going to benefit everyone. So we hope the discussions from here on in Karnataka move in that direction, and they don't try to outbeat UP or Maharashtra in the way the regulations are going in that direction. So I'll probably allow anyone in the audience, in case anyone wants to make a point relevant to this session, just a 2-minute thing.
I'd just like to make one point. The solar renewable segment is always with a lot of interventions. That's what makes this a truly a VUCA world, what we are living in. One has to be really highly dynamic, always see a silver lining. I also see a silver lining in the present this thing. The residential segment will continue to grow. Probably there will be more focus by a lot of people to get into the residential segment. And if you look at in terms of profitability today, the residential segment offers far more higher profitability when compared to even the C&I segment. There's tremendous amount of competition in the C&I segment, which Jay touched about it. Second, what I see is that in a very, very near short term, I'm talking about till March end, probably the capex will really pick up. We see a lot of capex orders picking up, a lot of people investing. And those, such of those corporates which really truly believe in renewable, they would have invested long time back. And for them, that investment will still be a must to have. There are a lot of players who will feel that solar at this kind of a economic junction will be a good to have one. They might not go, but it is those people who feel that renewable is must to have, is those people whom you need to go after. With these two things, I would like to end this. Thank you.
Anybody from audience want to have any quick remark or want to add to the pool of thoughts? Yes, sir, please.
We have been hearing that there is a loss of revenue for rooftop installation to the distribution companies. I just want to take a point to discuss. See, with 100 gigawatt as a target, we are going to achieve only 8 to 10% of the energy requirement of the entire country. Okay, and if 40% of that is going to be from renewable, so it's going to be only about 3.24% of the energy requirement. 4% of energy requirement of a rooftop segment, really does it matter to say that, okay, we are losing the revenue? I don't know. This point has to be considered.
Point, the entire pie.
It's a too tiny portion to say that it is going to affect them. Revenue loss is there and we want to take a control of that. Yeah,
I'll tell you. See, the rooftop is on C&I, correct? The DISCOM's revenue or the tariff, if you see, for these segments, they are high. So, if they go for power, then rest of the power consumption is there, which is free power, which is residential, maybe 4 rupees or even residential, if you see above 100 units or above 200 units, the tariff is 6 and 6.5 rupees. Yeah. Correct. So, the people who are putting rooftop are actually paying the higher tariff in DISCOM. So, the pain is coming from there that if they go for rooftop and take away their consumption from the renewable, the real revenue which, and they are the persons who are paying it promptly also, C&I and residential. The revenue which is generated to DISCOM is majorly from that, because otherwise the disconnections and other things, because they can enforce any kind of rule on the on such people. Rest of the things is the agricultural segment, or the some of the portion is T&D losses itself. So that is the reason where they feel the pinch, that if the high revenue paying or the high tariff paying people, if they go for complete solarization, so that is why they want to put some 50% in some states and 90% of your capital, so what is that, connected load and all those rules is to constrain that, because they have also invested in bringing the power transmission, distribution and all up to your doorstep. And then if you suddenly say that I will only use that facility to get the grid for back charging, and then if you start consuming, that is where the DISCOM pain is coming from.
You know, I would like to add, Mr. Revenkar, to this. This is there, but the fact is that the health of DISCOMs, most of the DISCOMs, barring a few, you know, they are in very bad shape. They subsidize power, they supply kind of free power or low cost power to agriculture. There's no tariff rationalization. It's a very large power sector issue. The capacity utilization power factors are down in this country below 60%. So we have a very precarious situation. So they are all stressed assets, basically stressed entities. So your question is very good, very meaningful. But since they are already stressed, that stress is not coming only from solar. If they were in healthy condition, then probably they would take a little bit of it. And other is the behavioral aspect of DISCOMs. There was a time, late 90s, you know, those days when furnace oil DG sets were the flavor for all process industries, you know, because there was this concept of export unit, oriented unit, and furnace oil was the cheapest source. So people had captive large multi-megawatt baseload DG sets. So that time also, every DISCOM put a surcharge on the DG power. I think today, even for DG power, because the concept of grid as a centralized power source, you know, it's a grid actually is very inefficient invention of industrial revolution, which has continued. You know, you have centralized power plants, you are feeding, centralized power plants are feeding power, you lose that energy in transmission line, then a lot of energy you lose in distribution and centralized. So now globally there is a shift, two shifts are occurring. One is that distributed, you generate and you consume, so there's minimum loss. And other shift is decarbonization of power. So in India, because power sector itself is, it's a big, what to say, you know, it's not where it should be. So because of that, these DISCOMs are in a state of stress. So when it's already stressed, so even a small thing, they react. And they also have that mental construct that we are a monopoly, so something touches our grid, then he must pay.
So I think as the industry is growing, the challenges are also changing. So earlier the challenge was only get the grid parity. So we've breached the grid parity, got the net metering regulations. So now the challenges are different. So as we want to keep on increasing the share of solar in the entire power generation mix, we'll have to continuously modify our business plans or technology offerings. And only through those things that we'll be able to probably able to achieve a much more higher share of solar. I think EV adoption also is going to help. So I think there are, there is like right light at the end of the tunnel. So let's see how the next decades, like the upcoming debate, how much we are able to increase the power generation through solar. So thank you very much. I think the entire room was very, very patiently listening, and the speakers and the audience were really amazing. I'll now request Mr. Ashok DM, chairman from Enerman Technologies, to present the mementos on behalf of the organizers to all the panelists on the stage, please.